Place? Gettysburg, in the state of Pennsylvania, in the United States of America. The year 1863. The small city nestled in the Pennsylvania mountains became an immortal name in the annals of war. It is the place where the bloodiest battle in the history of America was fought. It was here the Union armies met the armies of the Confederacy in the crucial and deciding conflict of the war between the states. In 1863, the cause of the Confederacy was at a crossroads. Their armies, usually victorious in the east, had been less successful in the west, where General Grant was threatening to capture Vicksburg and achieve control of the Mississippi River for the Union. With the west in jeopardy, General Robert E. Lee, in command of the armies of the east, formed a daring plan. He massed his forces for a quick and smashing victory in Pennsylvania that hopefully might bring a settlement in the war, and with it the independence of the South. In early June, the Army of Northern Virginia was moving in the Shenandoah Valley. The Union Army, intent on protecting Washington, cautiously headed toward the north, east of the Blue Ridge, which enabled them to retain a good defense of the federal capital. On the 28th of June, 1863, General Lee's scouts reported that Meade's Union Army was near Frederick, Maryland. Lee, anticipating a critical struggle, decided to bring his scattered divisions into a compact force. And so it was that Confederates from Chambersburg, Carlisle, and York converged on the central point, Gettysburg. It is an odd circumstance that the Southern Army approached Gettysburg from the north and west, while the Northern Army approached the battlefield from the south. It was Lee's strategy to fight the impending battle near Cashtown, 8 miles to the west of Gettysburg, which provided better terrain for an attack. General Meade, in command of the Federal forces, preferred a more defensible position farther south. But advance forces of both armies came to grips at Gettysburg, and without realizing it, brought on the climactic struggle at a point when neither commanding general had actually planned to wage the battle. These peaceful rolling hills, which harbor the farms of the Germans and Scotch-Irish, were soon to be tormented by the terrible terror of war. Poised for the fight, and soon to be involved in it, were 75,000 determined Confederates, pitted against 93,000 equally determined Federal troops. Two small brigades of John Buford's Union cavalry, the eyes of the army, were the first troops on the field. From the cupola of the seminary building, Buford spotted the gray columns of Confederates winding through Cashtown Pass. Buford deployed his thin lines of defense in an attempt to bluff the Confederates into caution until the main Union army could arrive. Fighting dismounted, Buford and his men took up a position on McPherson Ridge. The battle opened with the firing of 3-inch guns. The crew, perhaps with an instinctive sense of history, marked the piece that fired the first shot. The opposing forces first saw each other as the Confederates appeared on Hare Ridge. By the time the Confederates discovered Buford's thin line of defense, they were prevented from taking advantage by the arrival of General Reynolds' Union infantry, which thundered into action and drove the advance gray line back across the valley. Reynolds was killed at this spot, a short moment after his men went into battle. Replacing him in command was Abner Doubleday of baseball fame. John Burns was a Gettysburg shoemaker, 70 years old and a veteran of the War of 1812. When the action started, John Burns shouldered his ancient musket, fell into line with Meredith's Iron Brigade, and fought valiantly throughout the first day. He was wounded 3 times, but survived to become a national hero. In addition to the attack on Hare Ridge, the Confederates had also launched an advance somewhat to the north. This second attack was repulsed by the 14th Brooklyn, the only regiment named for a city instead of a state. At noon of this first day, Union cavalry outposts reported that Confederates were approaching on the Carlisle Road. These Southern troops formed an artillery line on this ridge and shelled the Union force. When the Union reply to the shelling seemed feeble, the Confederates charged but were driven back with severe loss. Meanwhile, more Union troops under Howard arrived and were deployed on this level plain. The fighting lulled until 3 o'clock, when fresh Confederate reinforcements went into action. And now, under attack from west, north, and northeast, the Union troops were dislodged and driven back, still fighting defiantly as they retreated. Union General Barlow, who was badly wounded in the action, was captured and fell into the chivalrous hands of Confederate General Gordon, who made arrangements for Mrs. Barlow to be brought to the battle lines under a flag of truce in order to nurse her husband back to health. The Union troops retreated back through Gettysburg, which was now under artillery attack from the Confederates. When the higher ground south and east of Gettysburg was reached, the Union troops took positions, stood firm, and held the Confederates in check. During the night, the opposing lines took clearer shape and form. But by now, the North had the advantage that their bloody delaying action of the first day had brought them. They had higher ground and a shorter and more compact line. On the second day, the field was quiet until late afternoon. The Union side was willing to wait. Some of the Confederate forces, misdirected and delayed by Union tactics, could not be brought into play for attack. Lee's plan was to attack Union left and right flanks simultaneously. The Union 3rd Corps, forming the left flank, had been moved out to a V-shaped position, with the left at Devil's Den and the center at the Peach Orchard. The chief engineer of the Union forces was G.K. Warren. Scouting the terrain from a rock on Little Round Top, he realized that this was a supremely important position and must be held. No opposing force could be seen. But to be doubly sure, Warren ordered a battery on Devil's Den Ridge to fire into the woods that appeared beyond the White Barn.